Welcome. We want to make sure everybody was settled in. It's so great to see a lot of students here. How many of you are currently management majors? That's a lot. Wonderful. And how many faculty are out there? I see a couple of faculty. I want to thank everybody for coming today. I'm Carol Crosby in Career Services. I'm an assistant director. And I want to welcome you to the Careers in Management panel program. We hold panel programs a couple of times a year so that all of you have an opportunity to meet professionals in the field. We were just talking at lunch about this, that we can, as career counselors, talk about careers in management that we're blue in the face, but it really doesn't mean as much, I think, until you meet and speak with people like our panelists. And so we welcome you to participate in this program with us. A couple of things. If you have never attended a panel program before, this handout, did everybody get a handout? Because there were handouts to pick up. It tells you how to attend a panel discussion. We're going to be talking as a group about management for just about 45 minutes. And then we're going to leave about 15 minutes, more or less, for you to ask questions as well. For those of you who are very shy, we're going to leave probably about 15 minutes to maybe even a half an hour afterwards for you to come up one by one and ask the panelists questions as well. So there'll be nice opportunities to do some networking. It's these kind of opportunities where you guys out there get a chance to talk to people in the field about where you're going, where they've gone, and what interests you about the organizations. I want to thank very much the management department for everything they did to pull this all together. They did a great job in helping not only with panelists, but also in bringing all of you students together. And I want to thank Alumni Relations and Institutional Advancement who served this lunch, very nice lunch, and also helped fund this program. You ready to begin? Ready to begin?
Yes.
There we go. Okay. So, a little quiet. On my left is Keith J. Benoit, class of 81. He is a vice president of North American sales and is responsible for retail corporate sales in the U.S. and Canada. Keith joined Ocean Spray in 1983 and has held multiple management positions in sales and marketing. Until his promotion to Vice President and Officer of the Co-op in 2012, he had been Managing Director with various general management responsibilities across Ocean Spray, branded beverage, foods, fresh fruit, and food service businesses. Prior to joining Ocean Spray, Keith worked in the public sector for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. He earned his MBA from the McCollum Graduate School of Business at Benton University, and his bachelor's degree is from GSU. Next to Keith is Patrick O'Connell. He is Vice President at AccuRounds, and he joined AccuRounds in 2003 as Operations Manager after 20 years of manufacturing operations knowledge from his leadership roles at world-class companies both in Europe and the United States, including Nestle, British Airways, and Northern Foods. Originally from Ireland, Patrick earned his bachelor's degree in industrial management from the Dublin Institute of Technology. He continues his executive education by attending numerous courses and workshops and is enrolled in the MIT Sloan School of Management Executive Education Program. On my right is Saré, Arnold. She is Talent Acquisition Manager for Enterprise Holdings. Saré graduated from St. Anselm College in New Hampshire with her Bachelor of Arts degree in Business. She began her career with Enterprise Rent-A-Car as a management trainee and worked her way up to management in field operations. After a few years with Enterprise, she was recruited to become a recruiter for the company. She has partnered with Career Services. We've worked quite a bit with her over the last 13 years, including her current role on the Career Services Employer Advisory Board. Last but not least, on my far right is Scott Longo, class of 89, VP IT and OT Transformation Program at State Street. Scott joined State Street Corporation after graduating from BSU with a degree in history in 1989. Early in his career, he worked as both a portfolio accountant and an advisor representative working with asset managers. In 1995, he assumed a management position within AMS servicing managers such as GMO, MFS, PIMCO? And Western Asset. In 1998, he joined Quincy Trade Processing as an assistant vice president and was responsible for the QTP help desk and metrics team. In 2002, Scott was promoted to vice president. Scott is a trustee here at BSU for the foundation and is a past president of the Bridgewater State Alumni Association. He is also a member of the Crossroads for Kids Advisory Board. Please give a warm welcome to our panel. So I'm actually going to start with a basic question that if you're even interviewing one person or networking with one person is a great question to ask. How did you all get into this field? Who would like to start first?
I'll rip.
Thank you.
What a lesson. We're a company right down the road here, if you don't know Ocean Spray, right down in the next town over in Lakeville. Because this is a little closer community, how many people in the audience knows someone or has a family member that works or has worked with Ocean Spray? Anybody here? One, two. First lesson, always know your audience before you talk. We talked at our lunch opportunity today about how did you get here, and I got to go back in time. I've been at Ocean Spray for over 30 years. It was one of those jobs. I'm going to go there for 3 years, finish grad school, and move on to my career, and it's just been a great fit. I came to Bridgewater State College back then. It was not the university. From a very blue-collar factory working family, and I was at another university, and my dad lost his job, and I wanted to continue my education. I was able to afford it here at Bridgewater State College at the time, worked on campus, and graduated in 4 years. And what was important to me is what I learned, because I came from a hillbilly farm town. That was my background. Had never left my hometown until I went to college, except for one trip to Fenway Park. And that was a Massachusetts native. So Bridgewater provided a huge opportunity for me. I interned at the State House under past Governor Weld. And it helped to really expand my horizons. And I was a poli sci, political science and history major. And I had a lot of accounting. That was the good part. Loved what I did. I'm going to go and I'm going to get into public life. I wanted to get into politics. And I hated it. 2 years, I worked for the Department of Mental Health. I had a great administration job, paid really well out of college. But people didn't want to work in the public sector at that time for the field I was in. My boss never showed up. I did all his work. He got paid 100 times more than I did. And it had just turned me off. So through some contacts, I put an ad in the paper. I mean, I answered an ad in the paper to get out of the business. I had made some contacts in the food industry. Answered an ad, and that's how I got into Ocean Spray Cranberries. Then got into grad school and then went on from there. So. A real roundabout way, but as I told people at lunch today, if it wasn't for Bridgewater State College at the time, I don't know what I would have done, because I couldn't afford to go anywhere else. So it was a great experience. None of these buildings were here, a couple on the hill, and that was about it.
Mm-hmm. And you said you were first generation.
I'm first generation ever to go to college, my family.
How many out there are first generation? Quite a few.
So it was probably a bigger deal for my parents than it was even for me to be able to vote, to be able to get an education. It was a big deal.
Patrick, you started overseas.
Yes, I'm originally from Ireland. I only moved to the United States in 1999. And my story, the company I currently work for is AccuRounds, we're an advanced manufacturing technology company, just located up on 24 in Avon, Massachusetts. But I started off when I graduated high school. I was scheduled to go to college, but unfortunately my father passed away, and I had to get a job to be born. And I ended up working for Nestle Corporation, who's the candy maker. And I was working for those guys for about 5 years, just going through the routine of having a job. Worked in an administrative role, just my high school diploma. And there was a guy in there, one of the senior executives, took me under his wing as a mentor and said, look, you're a smart guy, you're not really going anywhere here, you need to go out and get your third level of education degree. And I've recommended you get a degree in industrial management because it's a very broad-based degree but it's a really solid foundation if you want to continue your career with Nestle, you know, a multinational global corporation. So I did that, I went back to school, got a degree in industrial management, and then Nestle shut down their facility and moved back to the UK, so I didn't have a job. So then I had an opportunity to go to London, England, to Heathrow Airport and work for British Airways in airline flight catering. Had a sort of a supervisory role. But I had my management degree, so I had a lot of confidence in myself now because I'd gone back and taken that educational leap. So I worked with those guys for a couple of years, and then I had an opportunity to come back to Ireland. Worked for a company called Northern Foods, which is a frozen food manufacturing company, high volume product manufacturing sold into the European markets. And working there for probably 6 years, doing really well, moving up in my career paths. And then I met this beautiful American woman, fell madly in love, and moved to the United States. So now you remember, I was 20 years now, I've been working in food manufacturing. I had my industrial management degree. I had a reasonable amount of experience at a management level, but now I'm in a new country. I'm living in Syracuse, New York. There's no food manufacturing industry up there. So I had to schlep myself around a network, just like you guys are going to do today, make as many contacts as possible, and through some serendipitous interfacing, I got to meet this classic American entrepreneur who just bought this machine shop, an engineering company. Didn't really know why he bought it, it just looked like a good deal on paper, distressed asset. He bought the company, I met him. He said, what do you do? I said, I manage companies. He said, okay, you want to run this business? Now, I had no clue. I don't have an engineering degree, so I had no clue about precision engineering. But I knew how to manage businesses and processes, right? So you got three things. You got people, process, and product. And I just took a leap of faith and ran that business and fortunately turned it around. Subsequently then, my wife and my family, we moved to Massachusetts and I got a job with the company I'm currently working. So it's a real haphazard way of getting into, you know, manufacturing for me and then, you know, advancing your career path. So my point to you guys is don't be daunted by any field that you get into. Don't think, oh my God, I can't do this. You're doing the right thing now, you're setting yourself up with this fantastic educational program. You're going to come out of here with a fantastic degree. You guys can do anything you want.
Wow. We actually talked about zigzag careers at lunch, where you don't have to be thinking 20 years from now you're going to be here. Just take the next step. So really,
yes, my career was not quite as zigzaggy. The line at Enterprises, for all of us that work there, we didn't go to college to rent cars. We just ended up in the car rental business. So I have no huge affinity towards cars. I don't know the different models all that well now that I'm not in the field operations anymore. I just like to drive a new, clean car. And that's what Enterprise gives me the opportunity to do as one of our benefits. So probably a lot of people don't know this about me. My first job, paid position, was when I was in fourth grade working for a potato farmer picking potatoes. And the farmer would pick us up at 6 a.m. in his truck, and he'd drop us back off at 5 p.m., and we would get paid 50 cents a barrel for every barrel we picked. So this is the life in northern Maine. It's 8 hours north. It's very remote. There's no traffic light in the town. It takes 3 hours to get to the closest mall. So this is very, very backwoods.
You may beat me on
that. So, you know, I grew up with a family that worked very, very hard. My parents ran a grocery business, and my dad, you know, with a high school diploma, barely, he tells me that, a high school diploma, ran a very, very successful grocery business, probably working 100 hours a week. So I clearly don't have the work ethic that my father does, but I'd like to think it's stronger than most. So I think, you know, growing up, I was working in the grocery store, picking potatoes, whatever I had to do. And when I got to school, I ended up doing an internship at Lady Foot Locker, which again was not glamorous like the rental car business, but nevertheless, it gave me a great introduction to sales. It was the first time I'd had to pitch something and I was scared as could be. But I know for a fact that internship was really what gave me the confidence to interview for Enterprise And really and truly, I pursued the career because of the people I met. I felt comfortable with everybody that I met in the interview process. And I think, you know, I wasn't looking to work in a quiet office setting. If I had to be quiet all day, I think I would explode. So everyone I met at Enterprise was very, very friendly, outgoing. And I said, this is where I want to learn business. Like, I want to work with nice people like this. And so for 18 years, there's never been a reason to go anywhere else. We have amazing training in management. We have one of our finest interns in the audience. She's going to kill me, but Amanda Pimentel was an intern with us this past summer.
I don't see anybody blushing.
Hi, Amanda. I didn't know she was going to be here, but I just happened to peek up and see a friendly face. So if anybody wants to get the real deal on Enterprise, they can ask Amanda.
Perfect plug for my
internship. Thanks. Last but not least, I actually, my parents are both teachers. I grew up in Plymouth, not very far away. My mother knew what she wanted to do when she was a little girl. She wanted to be a first grade school teacher, and for the day she retired, she knew that was the most important job in the world. If you want to be a teacher, that's great. I studied to be a teacher to follow in the footprint, you know, and 1989, I graduated, I had done a wonderful student teaching experience, and there were no jobs. So my dad said, it's time enough to find a job. Your aunt works over there at State Street. Why don't you call her and call her, and maybe she can get you an interview. Which she was able to get me an interview, and I didn't get the job. So I wrote a letter right back to the career people. Who were the few hires? Somebody
yeah,
like
HR,
you.
HR, yeah.
I think you've made a mistake. Obviously, I'm very qualified. So they get me a second interview. I'll never forget it. It's this is bad advice. I'll just give it to you in advance. But they brought me back in for my interview. The guy's name was Sean. He sat down. He looked at me, looked at my resume, and said, do you have any questions for me? And I said, wait, it's an interview. You're supposed to have questions for me. He said, I read your resume, and I know all about you. And I said to Sean, oh yeah, tell me something you learned by reading my resume. And he said, well, actually, I didn't read your resume. Why don't you go through it? And I said, well, thanks for asking. And I went through all of my qualifications again, and I was shocked, literally shocked, when I got the job. Later on, he told me that it was the most interesting interview we had ever had, and he liked the fact that, although it probably wasn't the best thing to do, at least I was honest. I've been at State Street since 1989. It's been really a wonderful experience. I've done so many things there, which is one of the things that I really always pass on to people. It wasn't but for 4 years ago. I was always, any bad day I had, I was pining to be a teacher. I was going to quit like 1,000 times. Finally got to the point where I had to make a decision, either stay or go. And I remember this advice I got. It was actually this very tough boss that we all had, our big boss. She was a couple leaders up, and she's like, you know what? You're in operations. Look how you interact with your staff. You are a teacher. Every day you're teaching. I was like, ah, she's right. And I stuck with it. And this job, and a lot of people, I'm sure we all have similar experiences, because State Street's a big global company. Does anybody know State Street? Have anybody that works in State Street? A lot of people do. I've been literally around the world. I've been to India. I've been to all through Europe. I've done multiple different jobs. I've run operations groups. Right now I'm in an IT organization trying to do some transformational work. So it's really, I think, most important about kind of advice is that you never know where it's going to bring you. But what you have to do really is to bring all the experiences that you're accumulating along with you and really find a path that makes you look successful. One thing any manager will tell you, it's always the mix between the job you have and the type of person you're looking for. And nobody benefits if it's a bad match. So being yourself and knowing what you want to do is half the battle, especially on both sides of the equation. So that's kind of how I started.
Thank you all very much. That question really does help to get to know something.
And don't do it.
Actually, don't do it.
Do you guys advise to? What's the advice on that? What's the advice on that? Ask the question.
Ask the question.
Ask the question.
Our affecting interviewing guide has lots of questions you can ask. That's probably not one of them. But it worked for you.
It worked.
There are times when something's going to work for you that isn't going to work for somebody else. So it worked beautifully for you. How wonderful. That is a really great question, as you could tell, to ask when you're meeting someone. Another great question to ask that I actually ask on interviews, will help you to visualize whether you want to be in that position and whether you want that position one day. So I'm going to ask the panelists, describe a typical day in your work life, and then that's going to help you guys to think, do I want to be there someday? So who would like to start?
Yep. So, like I said, I'm in an advanced manufacturing technology company. Now, back in the day, your fathers or your grandfathers probably would have called it a machine shop. So, you know, your idea of manufacturing in the United States is probably based on some movies from the 50s. But it's not like that anymore. Advanced manufacturing, there's a renaissance in this country, huge opportunities. And the way that the manufacturing works now has changed completely. So, the majority of my day is not about managing data, it's not about telling people what to do. It's really about working collaboratively with the employees that we have. So all of our associates, you know, the individuals that work on the production floor are all technicians. And that whole line between blue collar and white collar, that's all gone. So we really refer to ourselves as new collar workers, knowledge workers in a technological environment. So my day in the morning is broken down. I use a tool in work called Leaders Standard Work. So you've probably heard of standard work when you're manufacturing a product, you've got a standard set of directions that you follow. Anytime you guys have gone to IKEA and purchase something and you take it out of the box, you've got to follow standard instructions. So there's standard instructions for production, but for leaders in sophisticated advanced manufacturing organizations, there's standard work for leaders. So my standard work is broken down into four elements. I've got 10% of my day is based on strategy, 10% is based on administration, 30% is based on people, and 50% is spent actually on the production floor, working with the associates and driving improvement. So my day, you know, when I come in the morning, first thing I do is I go to the production floor and check in with everybody. We look at the metrics, the scoreboard for the game, and it's not anecdotal evidence. We don't want to see what happened yesterday, we just want to know what's going on in the ground. So all our metrics are live, real-time data, just like you get at any sports event. And then we can decide what plays we're going to initiate during the course of the day based on what the scoreboard is telling us. So it's pretty dynamic. So I'm checking in to look at the process, but I'm also checking in to see how the people are doing. Then probably by 9:30 break time, I'm going to go look at email, do some administrative stuff. I'm going to be back out on the floor. And then a huge part of my day is selling the vision of the organization. So it's a coaching role, it's a teaching role. And again, I'm very conscious that I don't want to tell people what to do. If we've done a good job of, you know, developing the vision for our employees, they know what they need to do. My job is to make sure that their path to achieving that is as smooth as possible. There's going to be some strategic stuff during the day, which may be just a meeting maybe with the president or one of the other VPs, but it's a short portion of the day. And then the balance of the day is again back on the floor working with the associates.
How does your day compare?
Yeah, a little bit different. Having been there so long and had worked my way through different departments, the work is a little different. I'll tell you the story, but my advice would be, it's a great question for interviewing, especially for the position that you're going to interview for. And it'll really help you if you listen to what the person tells you. What I have advised people to do is pick that one thing that you think relates to what they said and go right after it and try to demonstrate that same point. So my story now is a little bit different. I usually have to spend time on the weekends to prep. I have a staff in North America of 85 people along with a network supporting us of about 3,000. We're responsible for about $1.6 billion in sales. So we prepare on the weekend. And a typical week for me, unfortunately, is 30% travel during the year. So I get to travel everywhere to meet with customers, meet with my own staff, meet with potentially new customers. And then the other 70% of the time is, unfortunately, in meetings. Mostly with our marketing and officers of strategy and tactical meetings, what we want to do with our brand and where we have to go. We have to have the confidence in our people that they'll take us where we need to be today, and we look to our management team to take us where we want to go tomorrow. So a typical day is a mix of meetings, a lot of FaceTime, a lot of communication. That's why when we look for employees in our company, and Scott said it a little earlier, fit is so important. When you're in a building and you're going to be interacting and communicating, you got to have the right fit. And if you don't like what you're doing, or it's just a placeholder for what you want to do, I'll tell you right now, people will pick it up and they'll know that. But if you're really interested in what you're doing, you think that's a huge opportunity, people will recognize that. So communication and fit are just really important. So when you're with me and you're sitting in meetings, 70% of the time, it's all FaceTime. It's not even technology anymore. It's FaceTime. Communication and writing. So that's a typical.
And you're hard to get on campus. Well, we've been working for a little while. Every year, because he's so busy. And you're on the road somewhere.
Yeah, I came off an international stint for 2 years, running Asia and Latin America, which made it a little bit harder. But we've been doing part of the mentoring program for 8 years. 8 years now.
Yeah. Get on my campus for you. How about that? And Saré, you do travel more regionally.
Yes, I'm definitely a little bit more local. And I think I can come at looking at management or a day of a life in two different perspectives, because I was a manager in the field operations before I went into the recruiting world. So I'm a talent acquisition manager now, which is a very fancy title for a recruiter. And so in the management, out in the operations, a typical day was, I was on the front lines with my staff. Amanda can attest to this. The managers don't hide in the back office when it's busy with customers. We're right out there in the front, answering phones, waiting on customers, and still managing the business on the front lines. And so that was really great for me, because again, I can't sit still for very long, and I like a lot of interaction, and it's extremely team-oriented. We cannot function if we don't help each other. You know, can I pull a car around for you? Can I do this for you? I mean, it's just, that's how we operate. We don't get paid on an individual sale. We get paid on how well we run the business. So how well do we drive revenue? How well do we control costs? How well do we run an efficient operation and therefore make the most profit? So that was kind of the management side of it. When we weren't with customers, we were working feverishly behind the scenes to make sure that everything would go smoothly the rest of the day, the rest of the week, the rest of the month. As a manager, I was always planning a month ahead, and I really made sure that my staff really only had to think about that day and that week, you know, so as not to kind of overwhelm them. We did a lot of training behind the scenes, that sort of thing. So that was a wonderful experience. I loved it. It was, like I said, a lot of management on my feet, which I really liked. Now in recruiting, still have a ton of interaction in my day. I'm in interviews probably at least half the day, if not a little bit more. When I'm not in interviews, I try to always be spend time doing things that will get me more interviews, more hires. So I'm prospecting on the phone, doing phone interviews, emailing people to set up interviews, tweeting, going on LinkedIn to post jobs, you name it. It's just interaction, like, over the top. And so it's a much different day now. I set my own schedule now more, which is wonderful to be able to kind of balance the family life, because having young kids at home is very challenging in itself. My day goes from 5 a.m. to, you know, 10 p.m. most days, but I love what I do. And so it really, I never drive to work feeling stressed that I have to go to work, because I always have great days. I never have a bad day at work.
I bet you're going to work. Not that you don't love it, but but that it's very different from what Saré is described.
Yeah, I think we all in common to all these answers are going to be just that it's our interactions that it's all about. So, you know, we're all kind of in that management area where a lot of times we're talking to people above us, which is all about trying to present ourselves. Even in our, you know, we've all been in the industry for a long time, but it's still all your interactions with people that above you and your peers is all very important. You know, it's very important to build up credibility in your career and to make sure that people see you as an expert in your field. But my favorite part of my day is always when I get to interact with the people. I'm a Do you guys have, anybody familiar with like lean methodology, process improvement? I know you probably are, but a lot of my last few years has really been about around work with people to improve their processes. So I love to interact with people that actually do the activities. And it's great because a lot of times if you've been doing a job for a while, people don't know what they do anymore. They know the screens they go to on this computer, or they kind of know a little bit about it. But when people are new, they're much more insightful about what they're actually doing and what they do add value to their customer, because they just get it at a real deep down level. So I always enjoy my part of the day where I get to interact with the people that are building our products and trying to help us add value to our customers, because that's really where you can still learn a lot. I don't tweet very often. I know some people do. But again, it's an amazing, at least in my where I work, it's amazing how the new people that come into the organization do fuel people at all levels, and it's really that interaction that I enjoy.
And everybody likes that interaction. It's all about. Thank you all. So this next question is, I think, important from our office viewpoint. We were talking at lunch about how difficult the economy is right now, and finding work is tough. And the most important thing that in our office, we think all of you in this room can do, is to gain, outside of your coursework, which is, of course, very important, to gain practical experience in some manner outside that classroom setting, to take what you're learning in the classroom and put it to practice. So I'm presenting this question to our panelists, is what type of experiences should these students here in this audience get to prepare themselves for the work you do? Who would like to start?
So, right? Ladies first this time. I personally think, because all of us have had experiences where it taught us what we wanted to do and what we didn't want to do. And so if you're sitting there thinking, well, I don't know really what direction to take, I would definitely network with folks that have, maybe the class that went before you who has already been through internships. I would definitely look for an internship and really try to get a little bit close to what you think you might want to do, but if it's not exactly what you want to do, don't worry about it. We were talking earlier, and one of us mentioned that even with folks that we've worked with over the years and maybe don't work with anymore, like, we're always happy to give recommendations. So you may do an internship, and if you go in every day with a smile on your face, ready to work hard, it doesn't matter if that work turns into a full-time job or not. That's going to be a reference for you down the road. I highly recommend continuing to build those professional relationships. Never burn any bridges. I look at my internship at Lady Foot Locker. I did get that through a friend. It wasn't rocket science. I did an internship, and my friend was a manager at Lady Foot Locker, and she said, I can get you an internship. So I don't even think I had to interview for it. But it doesn't matter. Like, I made the most of it. My manager and I kept in touch for years after I did that internship. It was only just during my senior year. But I used it as a reference when I was starting with Enterprise. And it did end up being kind of relatable with the sales aspect. So that would be my advice, is just take whatever professional experience you can get. And if you cannot, for whatever reason, do an internship, possibly spend your time with a job that at least gets you some transferable skills. So I'll give you a perfect example. Folks from Bridgewater work very hard. And many times I'll look at a resume and I'll talk to them about their customer service experience, and they'll say, oh, actually I've worked 7 years in a restaurant as a server. And I'm like, 7 years as a server? I mean, this is like music to my ears. And I'm looking on their resume, and most people will know to put it on their resume, but some people leave it off. It's not professional. But all those skills that you use as a server, multitasking, smiling, thinking on your feet, problem solving, customer service, sales, the list goes on and on, they're all transferable into this opportunity at Enterprise.
And Enterprise has a very good summer internship training program that I believe Forbes has mentioned.
Yes.
As being one of the better management training program. Just an aside, our office has almost 400 internships posted. So there's an internship for everybody in this room. And it's well worth looking at that. And if there may be funding available for internships through Diane Bell, she's our new internship advisor, internship director here on campus. So you should look her up in the directory and ask about internship funding.
Another thing I always get, you don't know exactly, how many people know exactly what they want to do? Any Wendy Longos in the room that know exactly? One.
One. No, one over there.
Couple.
Two.
We'll get to your, during the questions, but basically, every experience you have is on that road. It's okay to fail. This is a great time to experiment. If you think you might want to do something and you know somebody in that industry, go talk to them. Usually people are very receptive to talking about themselves. It's true, right? Don't ever minimize what you're doing or the things that you're learning in school, and to be very adaptable. At work, they call me an early adopter, which is, I don't even know what that means. It sounds very, but even, it's amazing how many things are really applicable to any job. Dealing with difficult people. It doesn't have to be a customer, internal to organizations they're difficult people. There's a lot of, just amazing amount of things that you never know when you need somebody that can do something or has some experience doing that. So even in school, you guys are probably better at putting together a presentation than we are, or some people in our organization. So don't ever minimize what you've learned, and when you get that opportunity, be ready to seize it. You know, it's the people that wait until they're looking for a job and then they start from scratch. It's always be going in that direction. Know where you want to go. If you want to be successful in the business world, then start trying to seek those opportunities, even if it's just in a classroom. It's every experience is worthwhile. You can fail, it's okay, it's not a problem. It really isn't.
What else? What other experience?
Yeah,
I'll
talk
about
internships. But I'm going to talk maybe more about what you can control today. And I have two college daughters, so this is the same advice in a debate I had for about 4 hours this past weekend with one of them. And that is, number one, in the field you think you're interested in, don't be afraid to understand the fundamentals. You don't have to be an expert. You don't have to go out tomorrow and be able to write a teaching plan, for example, or a marketing presentation. But understand enough of the basics of what you think you want to do, and that's going to whet your appetite for a great conversation when you are with someone. And if it changes, it's okay if it changes. You can go out and look into other opportunities and try to understand it. Just get that fundamental understanding of what it is. What I tell my own children, and the same for the mentoring program here, when I sit across from an intern opportunity or even a candidate that I'm going to hire, I look for communication. I said that a little bit earlier. Both written and oral is very important. And that's a skill. It doesn't matter what field you go into. You can utilize those two skills and maximize that, whether you're going to be an engineer, a teacher, or in business management. So really strong communication skills of written and oral. And then I take that one tier further in today's business environment. And it's all about how you present yourself and being able to do presentations, and sometimes even using some technology. Not overdoing it. But that's who you're all up against. Especially if you're coming out at the undergraduate, you're up against graduate students who are focusing on those three or four fundamentals that I just told you about. That's who you're going to be competing with. So that core foundation, if you want to call it that, is what I look for, whether it's an intern that we're going to hire or even an employee or someone that we're going to employ who may have had 10 years of experience. I'm looking for those qualifications that they have. It'll put you on the same part. If I have to make a choice between a young professional and an older someone in the field for a longer period of time, the tiebreaker is going to be communication and how they presented themselves. Because that I'm looking for that right person and the right fit. My only comment on the intern program, this was the 4-hour debate with my daughter, is I truly believe internships are a wonderful way, especially in this economy, to break in. And then you get the networking we talked about and the experiences. But I also, this is my debate with my daughter, you don't have to go overseas. You don't have to leave the country
Because a lot of universities and schools, not here, but others will say, hey, it's wonderful, have an experience and do an internship, you know, in Ireland. It's a fabulous place to go. You don't have to do that. There are so many opportunities right here where we are in the U.S. that you don't have to go through that expense and feel the pressure, my friends are going, I have to go. There's plenty here. So that would be my advice on that.
And most of them are local. Most of them are fairly nearby and 10 to 15 hours a week. It's not a lot.
It's a big asset for a company like us down the road. We bring on probably anywhere 5 to 10 internships per summer, and we'll also work with schools if they have co-op programs. And our hiring rate's probably 25-30%, where we'll make an offer to an undergraduate or a graduate student in between the last semester of their education while they're still in school. That's the kind of people that we're looking for.
And by the way, if you struggle with having time for an internship, again, it can be 10 to 15 hours a week. It's not full time. We also have the Job Shadow program during winter break. The deadline is, I think, November 1st, Katie, am I correct? November 1st is the deadline. The application is online on our website, and you can do a one-day job shadow. We've got one at State Street coming up. We've got one at, let me see, there's State Street and Meditech, and I believe there's one more. So there's some opportunities, Wells Fargo, opportunities to go out and do a one-day job shadow during winter break.
I'm sorry, what was the date of the deadline?
November 1st is the deadline. You can actually start applying, I believe it's by October 15th online for the one-day job shadow. And remember all those internships. Patrick, how about you? What experiences do you recommend that students get before they are hired by you?
Covered a lot of those elements. You know, in the space that I'm in, which is manufacturing, advanced manufacturing, you look for individuals who have tremendous problems, obviously. And you know, we use a system called lean manufacturing to drive continuous improvement. Because you've got to think about it this way: in the space that I'm in, manufacturing, all the technology and the equipment that we use can be used anywhere else on the planet. So you have a facility just like ours in Singapore, or in Sao Paulo, or Dublin, or anywhere. So it's very democratizing. So my only competitive advantage is my people and their ability to solve problems and draw on all their creativity, the full person, we're looking for the full package, physical, mental, spiritual, the whole thing, to come and draw on that exceptional ability and drive our organization forward. So, you know, for individuals here, it's all about their ability to solve problems. The best, you know, opportunities like that come by coming to a facility like ours and interning. Maybe over a summer period, we had an intern last year for 3 months, it was when we paid their salary. And they worked on a specific project, and we showed them how to work through the process of problems, plan, do, check, act, it's just a cycle. That's an incredibly important tool. And then the other thing that I would recommend, because you guys are just starting out on your careers now, is don't, when you're approaching anything, and I commend everybody here for saying yes to coming here, you say yes to every opportunity to present itself. Go to all your professors, ask them what's available, go to the faculty here at the school, push back to see what opportunities are available. Because you've got to think about it this way, it's not, when you go into a situation, you don't want to say to yourself, what am I getting here? You want to say, what am I becoming? That's the key change. And there's a lot of opportunity to become much greater than you are now, and that's where your career is going to expand.
That's actually some of the greatest advice I've ever gotten. I actually met a vice president at ABC, and he said that to all the students that I went with. He said, always say yes. And from then on in, and I was an older professional, every time my boss says, could you do something, I'll say yes, before I even know what it is. Which has gotten me into trouble a lot of times, but it's well worth it. Perfect segueing into my next question. Oh, before I go into this next question, we have a job and internship fair next Thursday, 1 to 3 in the ballroom. 60 employers coming, including Saré. So you can go up to her and say, Saré, I met you at the panel discussion last week, and I'd like to talk to you about...
See if you link in before you get there. Huh?
Yeah, networking. So we'd love to have everybody in the room come and see what they can get for both jobs and internships. But this is, again, a perfect segue into the last question I'm going to ask. And I'm going to ask this last question only because I really want to spend a lot of time with you guys asking questions of our panelists. So I'm starting to think about what question you'd like to ask. But the question I want to ask them, which is my favorite at a panel discussion, is what are your words of wisdom for our audience out here? Love this question, because we get some incredible answers out of this. Who would like to start?
You guys all looking at me?
You're the wisest one in the room.
If I had to pick a few key words, it's never give up. You don't know, you don't even know what you don't know. I hate to tell you that. And even after 30 years in the industry that I'm in, I learn things every day. I learn it from sometimes my staff. I learn it from the people I interact with. But where you are in your life cycle and what is out there, again, I hate to pick up my children are your age, so I'm going to treat you like my children. You don't know what you don't know. You may think you know a lot. You may think, I got it sold. I'm going to go do this, and I know this. I've had the opportunity to travel internationally, from Asia, South America, all over this world. And I learned so much. We are in such a small slice of what's out there and available to all of us to do different things. Whether that's things that you do from a more charitable position because that's what's important to you, to a working career and raising a family. You just don't know. And my children come home and they say, Dad, I know what you do, I know what Mom does, but I'm not sure what I'm gonna do, and they're all nervous. I said, don't worry. I said, take your experience that you're getting right now in your college experience and just be open to what can happen. Now, I think one daughter's changed her major maybe 3 or 4 times, but that's okay. She's experiencing the different things, meeting people. We come from all of us, and probably most of us here are from Massachusetts, I would guess. I was. And we live in a very small part of our own little country. And you would be amazed if you haven't had the opportunity of what it's like to travel in the South. Or what it's like to travel in I call it the world of fruits and nuts out in California. Totally different. Totally different. But their perspective, and think of the entrepreneurship that comes out of the state of California. Totally different. So my advice to you is never give up, never stop, and don't think you know it all. I'm just telling you, don't. I can tell you right now today, I don't know it all. That would be my advice.
That's a point made that's really valid. In terms of, you don't have to sweat the small stuff, you don't have to worry about having an end in mind. Just focus on the things that you can control, which is what you're doing right now. Focus on your studies. Do the absolute best you can with those. And then have it, as you're developing a sense of what your ideal job would be like, think about that a lot. What it's going to feel like being that ideal job. It doesn't have to be the specifics of what you're going to be doing. You might start out with one career and end up with a different career. Think about what that's going to feel like, that kind of job, what it's going to feel like for you on a day-to-day basis, the satisfaction that you're going to get from doing that work. And over time, that will, what I've seen it happen, it will come to you. But not by the way you think it's going to come. That's the way you're going. It's going to be an incredible experience. It's so exciting.
Yes, so I've managed a lot of people and been managed by a lot of people through my career. I think if you're going to have a career in management, so I work for so many people, right? There have been some managers that were very, very strong leaders and other managers who weren't as strong leaders, but they were a very good person. And I found that I can work for anybody as long as they're a good person. So I think if you're going to go into management, obviously you have to work on your leadership skills, but be the type of person that other people want to work with. When companies do layoffs, the person who works hard, has a positive attitude, comes into work every day with a smile on their face, those are not the people that get laid off when the economy is bad, typically. So that's my advice, I think, is just be a good person and work hard for your company. And that little bit of humbleness that you talked about, like,
you can have a good mix between being humble and being confident. And I think if you find that right mix, then you're going to be the type of person that everybody wants to work with.
Yeah, that's really the thing, I think. You know, I've met a lot of people, and it really, I've never met a person that's really kind of a decent, deals with people in a very honest and straightforward way that doesn't get ahead, you know. And it's easy, because you see people, and sometimes you meet somebody new, and they're like, hey boss, 2 weeks in, I'm ready to do the next thing. I'm ready to do two things up. I want your job, and they're a little bit too aggressive. Always understand that what you're doing, what you've been asked to do, is you need to really focus on that, because that's what stands you against your peers. And somebody that understands what they're doing is helping the greater organization. And it's interesting, the people that come to me and say, hey, how will it help me get ahead? What am I doing today? Are the people that opens up a lot of different avenues for discussions around what they want to do, and to teach them a little bit more about the detail of their job. Because you never know when the next opportunity is. A lot of times through those interactions, you find out they have a real passion at some aspect of work, or they had some experience somewhere else, so you can actually start to leverage sooner. It's really the people that really understand that, you know, that if you've been given a job to do, you do it well, and you're decent with who you deal with, and then you always will get ahead, I think, because who doesn't like to work with people or even go to school with people that are decent?
What about questions from the audience?
I want to know what that gentleman wants to do.
Yeah, me too.
I work for EC Machine Design Corporation out of Hanson, Massachusetts. It's a short run machining company. It's a family business, so I'm quite on taking over lots of customers.
Who has no idea what they want to do? Oh, good.
Questions, everybody? Oh, there we go. We have to have a few questions.
I have a question for Mr. Benoit for Ocean Spray. You said you deal a little bit with marketing. What kind of marketing campaigns do you do for Ocean Spray?
Yeah, professionally, in my 30 years, I have 18 years of my work there is in sales, and 10 years has been in marketing. So I ran the food business, and I've also run the beverage business. My claim to fame, if you guys watch our commercials on TV, I hired those two guys to stand in that hot, cold water. Great campaign. That's my claim to fame. But it's been indeed the marketing piece, and having been on both sides of the fence, sales side and a marketing side, I was just one of the fortunate ones that always said, whoever said it, it's true, always say yes. Because that leaped me from sales, the opportunity vertically in my company. It wasn't a promotion, but it was an experience opportunity just because I kept saying yes to get in the marketing side and to have that opportunity. So today, when I go into one of those meetings with my marketing and sales team, I sat on their side of the table, so they can't pull the wool over your eye. You've been there, you had the experience. So the marketing side was just another great experience that I had the opportunity to have. My MBA, my graduate degree, was in marketing. In brand marketing is what I was focusing on, so it was a nice fit for me.
Another question. Yes, right here.
I've heard from a few teachers here that you have to have at least 2 internships before you graduate from college to get into a lot of companies these days. So I was just wondering, like, if your specific companies have certain requirements for how much internship experience you've actually had, or if they're just generally looking for, like, well-rounded experienced people.
We don't have a number like that. But it's the experience, and it's your resume. You mentioned whatever's on your resume is what you're going in with. So it's really doing the research on that company to see what might be applicable to your experiences. But try to do an internship, or try to, and I think, one of the most important things there is you get to experience an organization to see if you're even interested in that field. So maybe you'll end up diverting from that, so it's a good experience there. But at least we don't have a quota. Is anybody else have a
quota? No, we don't. One is usually is great. Never more than one. I like Saré said though, it's the other stuff on your resume that can make a difference. And I hate to do it to you guys, but this is the daughter's speech. They've worked 6 years in an ice cream shop in the summer. And they're actually running the store now. They're the oldest, they've been the longest. I said, you don't know what that's going to do in the future on your resume when you get out. I said, it's going to weigh in. I mean, who would have thought scooping ice cream and, you know, in the seventh grade? You never know.
We will hire them because anyone who will get sticky with ice cream will also wash cars in a suit.
We hire them because they'll make sure we invest all of our money at the end of the day and not go home before they. I mean, it's applicable. If you can close the shop, you can do pretty much everything because, you know, that's the moral there.
And actually, if you are struggling to figure out how you can sell your job to any of these people up here who hire, bring it to our office, to a drop-in or appointment. And we can do a very good job of taking what you're doing now in any experiences and slanting it in an appropriate and factual way towards the type of jobs that you're going to be looking at. And we can even show you how to take a job description or internship description and sell those transferable skills on your resume towards that description. It takes a little work, but we're going to teach you how to do it so you can do it for life. And that's what our office is all about. Anybody else want to add something about that? Patrick, did you want to add anything?
Internships and opportunities.
And the two internships.
No, on a resume, if somebody's going to come to our facility, I'm going to be looking for a lot of the prep work that they did during the 4 years they were in school, and any particular projects that they worked on specifically with the professors, if there was a problem solving initiative. And during the interview, I'd ask them to talk about their own experience through that process, about the process and also what they did.
And I can add, we do something called a competency-based interview. You guys familiar with that? Just basically you get people to tell a story about a work experience, and then we have criteria about what we're hiring, so you're trying to get somebody to tell a story that they feel comfortable to tell. And that's why an internship's good, because you go, what did you do in your internship? And you're able to explain it. And then based on your experience, we're like, oh, that's a good fit for what I'm looking for. We work at a bank, lots of procedures, and I met a kid who had a work experience, and he liked to be creative and didn't like to follow rules and do it. Well, that's good in another industry, and it wasn't he was a bad person, but it gives those experiences to be able to really match you off with the job.
And we actually do practice interviews where we can do that competency and behavioral based work with you and get you that sort of thing. Another question out here. Yes.
Are there any campus-related experiences that you would encourage students to consider during the time here at Bridgewater that you feel would be beneficial to their one being hired and two potential advancement in the company?
I have a unique experience. I was actually the student trustee. Do you guys have a student trustee still? I think so, right? In the late 80s. Go look up on the website and you'll know when I was here. But basically, that gave me an experience. We went through some campus turmoil, I guess I call it, and what that allowed us to do was just kind of deal with crisis and deal with real life situations. And you know, anything, because the student government gave us the opportunity to manage the budget, there was just a lot of applicability there. So I did, in my early interviews, talk a lot about that experience, because you know, it's real stuff. Also, I played some sports as well. I think anybody else was into sports. But anything you can turn into something, if you try to.
You're working with athletes here on campus, so you definitely
know the sports
as well.
Yeah, the sports is awesome for your leadership, your work ethic. There's so many positive teamwork. There's so many positive sports. You can definitely sell that in an interview as transferable skills. But also, I know that a lot of you are spread very thin. So you're working, you're going to school, and you can't spread yourself, you know, so thin that you can't commit to things. But if you do find the time to get involved in something on campus, pick that one thing and like really get involved in it. You know, like really put your all into it and have some stories to tell. When we ask you in an interview, you know, have you had a tough situation with a team member? And where maybe one member wasn't pulling their weight or wasn't engaged in the process, and what did you do? so that you can really give a good story. Like, well, I talked to the person, I found out they were actually going through a tough time. It wasn't that they didn't want to be involved in the project. And I got them looped back in, and we found some times to meet that worked better for them, and
etc. In fact, I just thought of something where a lot of times when you ask somebody, tell me about a difficult situation, a lot of times it's interesting. I end up hiring a lot of people that got like a D in this class that they thought they were going to fail, and they stuck with it. Something about that, and people have the courage to talk about it and how proud they were because they went way beyond what they thought they were capable of. It's amazing what kind of piques your interest when you're actually meeting with somebody. You know, there's somebody, I got an A in the subject or that subject, but it's the people that have went through some sort of turmoil. A lot of people, you know, I'm sure a lot of people working through going to college, and that's a tremendous story in itself to be able to start to think about how you'll market yourself to get that next opportunity.
We actually advise that people put on the resume, work part-time or going to school full-time, or paid 100% of schooling to get that on the resume, because there's a lot of students who don't out there. They work no hours or 10 hours a week. And many of you, how many of you work 20 plus hours a week? Oh, there we go, look at that. That's important to go on your resume.
Yeah, I mean, you got to think about yourself in terms of any opportunities where you have to take a leadership role, or a role where you can foster collaboration with your fellow students. Always think of yourself in terms of being a linchpin and not a cog. It's really important.
That's one of those operational analogies you get to use.
Yeah, I love that. But that's what you're thinking of. So any opportunity like that, it doesn't have to be super leader, but it can be something at a lower level, smaller, collaborative stuff that you're working on. Maybe you took a lead on a project in the class. Anything like that where you can show, where you can take an initiative. That's really what we're looking for, is initiative. Because after initiative comes leadership, but you have to take the initiative first. So that's what you want to show in your resume. I took initiative here, I took initiative here. I was in a class, it wasn't working out, I took the initiative to change. I went into this class and then I was successful. Anything like that where you have an initiative, that's really, really important.
You went to school here, so do you have any
recommendations? Yeah, I've been on the student council piece. I guess I was a poli sci geek back then, if I look back. But I had a great time being a geek here, so that was good. I do remember, and I actually used it in both of my jobs that I, when I went to the state position I had, and then again at Ocean Spray. I can't even remember how it came up. I think a professor approached me and said, hey, the town selectmen are trying to work on some of the energy initiatives back in the late 70s with the energy crisis and all that, and they're just looking for some help. Would you be interested? Sure. The answer is yes, I'll do it. And it turned into a project that the town actually ended up being state funded for. And they did this whole article on the project, and I was in the article. So I cut the article out and made it as part of my portfolio. So when they said to me, you know, tell me some things that you've done, well, let me show you some things that I've done, and it was able to really show that. So picking that one thing, I think is probably better because you're much more focused. And just do the best that you can, and then leverage the heck out of it. And it was I think it was through student government that was how we ended up into that forum. So it worked well. A little tidbit you probably wouldn't find in the archives. I actually was the student leadership of the year that year for that project at Bridgewater State College.
Wow. And did you put it on your resume?
I absolutely did. It's still there. It may still be there.
Unfortunately, we're ending. I always think these panels are too short. We can talk a lot more, but I know your class has ended. So, you have an evaluation form. I'd really appreciate it if you would fill it out. We do use that to help us make decisions as to our next panel. And I once again want to thank the Department of Management, but most of all, please, let's give a round of applause for our panel.